Please pray with me. Lord, Lord God, with your word, silence in us any voice but your own, and may the word of my mouth and meditation of all of our hearts be pleasing and acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and redeemer. Amen. This morning, our Old Testament lectionary text takes us to the book of Joshua. Joshua is the first of the history books, moving us from the Torah, the books of law, which are the first five books of the Bible, into the history of the Israelites. Preaching from Joshua is a little complicated. It includes stories of conquest and land grabbing, supposedly divinely sanctioned by God, that are quite problematic. The original manifest destiny, if you will. But most biblical scholars and historians agree that the archaeological data and actual findings of history don't tell the story the way it is portrayed in Joshua. In fact, Richard Nelson, whose Hebrew Bible focus is the book of Joshua, says, "The stories and other materials taken up in Joshua cannot be used directly as historical evidence for violent conquest. The stories were told to serve theological and nationalistic interests, not historical purposes." So we read Joshua not for its facts, but to get a sense of how the Israelites viewed themselves as a nation and how they understood their relationship with God. The person, Joshua, for whom this book is named, took on the mantle of leadership for Moses. Moses, you'll remember, led the people out of slavery from Egypt and through the wilderness to the Promised Land. He himself did not get to enter the Promised Land. In fact, most from his generation did not, which should really tell us something about allowing the next generation to take leadership and to take us into the next phase of our church here at Calvary and American Christianity as a whole. Most of us, no matter how important we've been, even if we have been Moses of Calvary, will not get to see and experience much of what is to come. And if we want to be Calvary Presbyterian Church that is doing the faithful work of God 150 years from now, we would be wise to start listening and allowing our youth and young adults to lead us today, not sometime in the future, but today, so that we are ready and still relevant, and quite frankly, so that there still is a future. Don't get me wrong, the Church of Jesus Christ will never die, but individual congregations do close every day. Calvary is lucky enough to have youth being confirmed, and young adults joining, participating in leadership, and even sitting on our section. We need to listen and follow their lead, not just because they're young, but because they bring fresh perspectives and understandings of God and the world that can help us as we seek to be a faithful church in the world. As it is, Moses saw the Promised Land from a mountaintop, but would never actually enter it. They couldn't have gotten there without him, it's true. But he wouldn't and couldn't be able to lead them the rest of the way. That required new leadership. Joshua is the one who would then take the people into the Promised Land, establishing a landedness and nation state that had been missing so long for them. Here in chapter 24 that we heard Larry read, we actually witness the end of Joshua's life and ministry. What he has set out to do has been accomplished. So before he dies, he re-establishes a covenant before God and God's people, giving the Israelites a choice. "Choose this day whom you will serve," he says. "Will it be this God Yahweh who set you free from bondage, who brought you through the wilderness, who has been faithful and present during each and every time of transition and change? Or will you choose other gods, lowercase g, gods that woo with promises of instant prosperity and comfort, gods that might be more tangible because there are images and figures of them which you can see and hold? Whom will you serve?" And the people don't really hesitate. They say, "We'll serve God, the one who's been with us, the one who was with our ancestors and forebears, maybe not right now, but at some time in our history, perhaps we have felt the love and comfort and peace that God offers. We remember God and the great possibility of the one who is life and light and God. So like the Israelites, we choose God. But Joshua asks the people again, are you sure? Are you sure you choose God? Because choices have consequences. And this isn't a decision you can make half-heartedly. It is a commitment of your whole life, your whole way of being. It is a change in orientation, and oftentimes a full reversal of what the world holds as important or as valuable. To choose God is so hard sometimes that Joshua basically tells the people in verses 19 and 20, no, I don't think you can actually do this. Don't commit, because you're just going to fall short on your end of the covenant and make God upset. Now, I can't know for sure if Joshua actually believed God would not forgive them or turn away and cause harm to the Israelites for faltering on their promises. God had forgiven them over and over and over again through their flaky commitments in the wilderness. So I don't know why Joshua would think that would stop. But I do think he's giving them a fair warning that their actions must accompany their words, that their choices must have consequences, to take seriously this decision before them. Because when we choose God, God expects us to live accordingly. Yes, there is grace when we falter, and of course we are saved by grace alone and faith alone, but a healthy life of faith is known and shown through the way we live our lives. It is demonstrated by our actions. As it says in Matthew 7, you shall know them by their fruits. To choose God, and for Christians that means to follow in the way of Jesus the Christ, who is God incarnate, is not easy. It requires humility and meekness in a time when pride and strength and greatness is valued. It requires love and grace, radical love and grace that calls people to the best, to their best selves, not just accepts and welcomes them as they are, but loves them enough to challenge and bring about transformation in their lives. Anne Lamott, author and absurdly honest Presbyterian, says, I do not understand the mystery of grace, only that it meets us where we are and does not leave us where it found us. True love and grace meets us where we are. It does not leave us where it found us. It is honest with us, confronts us, and loves us into a new way of being. To choose God, to follow Christ, means to stand with those who are the most vulnerable, oppressed, and marginalized in our society. Consider those who are the most despised, those who are the scapegoated and most expendable. That's with whom Jesus kept company. Prostitutes, tax collectors, the sinners, not the saints. Another Christian author writes, be like Jesus. Spend enough time with sinners to ruin your reputation with religious people. Theology teaches us that God has a preferential option for the poor. Notre Dame Center for Social Concerns, with its root in the Catholic Church, frames it like this. As followers of Christ, we are challenged to make a preferential option for the poor, namely to create conditions for marginalized voices to be heard, to defend the defenseless, and to assess lifestyles, policies, and social institutions in terms of their impact on the poor. The option for the poor does not mean pitting one group against another, but rather it calls us to strengthen the whole community by assisting those who are the most vulnerable. From the scriptures we learn that the justice of a society is tested and judged by its treatment of the poor. God's covenant with Israel was dependent on the way the community treated the poor and the unprotected, what we read again and again in the Hebrew scriptures in the New Testament. The poor are agents of God's transforming power. In the Gospel of Luke, Jesus proclaims that he has been anointed to bring good news to the poor. Similarly, in the Last Judgment, we are told that we'll be judged according to how we respond to the hungry, the thirsty, the prisoner, and the stranger. Therefore, the preferential option for the poor is not optional. The Latin American Bishops' Conference at Medellin and Puebla aimed to emphasize the use of option as a verb rather than as a noun. As such, each Christian, each one of us, must make a choice to lift up the poor and disadvantaged in very real and concrete ways. Preferential option for the poor means that Christians are called to look at the world from the perspective of the marginalized and to work in solidarity for justice. To choose God means to choose that which does not serve our own needs or our own privilege. It means to courageously choose again and again and again life and love, justice and mercy. And we have to keep making that commitment, preferably in community, as a church, because it's much too easy to choose anything and everything else. It's quite natural to do what's easiest for us. It's quite normal and even lauded to act in our own self-interest, to make sure that what we want and our legacy continues in perpetuity. It's human nature to want to be comfortable, to want security in what's familiar, to want power and influence. It's natural to falter, to fear. These are all lowercase g, gods. When we choose God, the creator of the universe, the one who came to live, die, and rise again among us, we choose another way, a harder way, but the way that leads to and life and love and ultimately even deep and profound joy. It is hard, but it is possible. For all things are possible with God. And God does not leave us to do this work alone, but sets us with others in a community of faith and walks with each of us in this difficult yet life-transforming journey. Last week, many of us came home from church and learned of the horrific shooting in a small Baptist church in Sutherland Springs, Texas. I don't know if that church would let me preach in their pulpit. I'm pretty sure their pastor and I have many theological and political differences. We may not agree on a lot of things, but they have faced terror, death, and grief this week. Entire families, children, dead. And did you know they're worshiping today? The broken, devastated, traumatized remnant of First Baptist Church of Sutherland Springs gathered today to pray, worship, and ultimately to choose God. In spite of what they've been through, or perhaps because of what they've been through, they came together to worship today. That's courage. Refusing to give in to fear, and with this act, they pronounce boldly to the world that we are a resurrection people. Death does not have the last word when we choose God. Fear will not overcome when we choose God. This morning, we stand in solidarity with the good people of Sutherland Springs. We see and share their communion, and we stand with them, because if they can do it, we can too. We choose God. In honor of their Baptist tradition, we'll sing together an old Baptist hymn. Contrary to popular belief, this song does not capture the ease of making a decision to follow Jesus, but rather the staggering cost of picking up your cross and following after. As we all sing, Victor and I will light candles for each life lost in this terrible tragedy, trusting in the hope of the resurrection, praying for those who weep and grieve, and professing through our singing that we choose God this day and commit to action. Amen. May God's light and love